So, regular town council meeting. May I have a roll call, please?
Chairman Carson?
Here.
Counselor Barry?
Present.
Counselor Fritz?
Here.
Counselor Watson?
Here.
Counselor McGinty?
Here.
Counselor Roberts?
Here.
Counselor Swift Kayata?
Here.
Thank you. Pledge of allegiance?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Do we have any presentations, sir? There's no presentation. Reports and correspondence. I know we have council reports, but the town clerk also has a report, short report she'd like to mention.
Thank you. Just two quick things for residents to maybe think about a little bit. Nomination papers for council and school board are now available. They are due back in my office on or before Monday, March 20th. We have 3 seats available for the council and school board. All the seats are 3-year terms. Requirements are between 25 and 100 registered voters of Cape Elizabeth. If anybody has any questions, we'd be happy to answer them. Just please call my office. And the second thing is the recent death of Linwood Dunham has made available the Boston Post cane. This is given to the oldest resident of our community. The holder must have resided in Cape Elizabeth for a minimum of the last 15 years. It may be given to a former resident living in a nursing home or with their family in Greater Portland if the person spent the principal portion of their lifetime up to that point in Cape Elizabeth. So if anyone has any suggestions, please let me know. And I would really like to have the information back in my office by Friday, February 25th, so that we can make a presentation soon thereafter.
Thank you very much. Now, reports from other counselors. Ann Swift?
Excuse me. Two things. I attended on February 19th a meeting of the Council of Governments in Portland. They did a really interesting presentation on agricultural development in Maine. And also we had a discussion on sharing municipal services with other Cumberland County towns. If anybody wants further information about that, either on the council or out in the public, feel free to give me a call. The people had some good ideas from other towns. And then on the 25th of February, I was fortunate to attend the signing of the triad agreement between the Cape Elizabeth Police, the State Attorney General's Office, the Cumberland County Sheriff's Department, and the SALT Senior Advisory Council. And I just want to commend Chief Pickering and also Paul Gaspar, our community liaison officer, for their work on putting together this really important agreement. I think it's going to be beneficial to the whole community.
Thank
excuse
you.
Me.
Jack, do you want to comment about it?
I think you said the 25th of February.
I'm sorry, of January.
January, that's what I thought.
Yeah. Thank you. Jack? Getting ahead of myself.
Madam Chairman, I won't steal your thunder because I suspect you'll speak to it as well, but I did want to commend you on your great presentation for the opening of the pool. And for those of you that weren't there, and there were a good number of people, you really need to get down and see it. It is gorgeous. But I'll let you talk about the presentation.
Well, you can continue to make the report. About the pool, because I wasn't going to say anything.
Don Richards was there to get a presentation. We had a swim diving team that came down from mid-state to give a demonstration on that. And there probably must have been, I'd say, 150 people in attendance for the opening of the pool itself. And it was well done. The whole ceremony took about an hour and a quarter, which was way beyond what I expected. So it was done upright.
Well, I planned it for only 30 minutes, so maybe it wasn't done right.
If I could add, I've heard excellent comments about the fitness facility and the people who work there, too, from numerous citizens.
I think we have a great team in place at that whole facility,
very
both the pool side and the fitness side.
All right.
Thank you. Anybody else?
Yes, just from the Historical Preservation Committee, we'd like to thank the entire council for meeting with us in workshop to give us some direction. And we are going to meet the Historical Preservation Study Committee. We'll meet on the 24th of February, and we're going to try to address some of the points that were brought out in the workshop session with the council, for which we are grateful.
Thank you very much, Henry. Got to add over this side, yes. Carol.
I just wanted to mention that I've agreed to take on the chairmanship of the Regional Waste Systems Recycling Committee. which I have longstanding great interest in, and so I'm going to be spending even more time at Regional Waste System than in the past. So I'm excited about where that, where Regional Waste System is proceeding in the lines of encouraging recycling in the whole region of Greater Portland.
I'll be happy to pass my baton from the sewer queen to the recycling queen from my previous years. Hearing no other reports, the town manager's report, please.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chairman. First this evening, I wanted to congratulate our Chief of Police, David Pickering, who happens to be here this evening. Some of you may have noted that David has been named the Maine Chief of Police of the Year, received the Chief's Award from the Maine Association of Police. The Maine Association of Police is the professional association representing police officers from different communities throughout the state, and they recognize David on his leadership within Cape Elizabeth, his leadership last year as the president of the Maine Chiefs of Police Association, and his general defense of police officers in recognizing their professionalism and in watching out after their safety as he displayed so evidently throughout his term of service as the president of the Maine Chiefs, and looking forward to that. So I know you join me in congratulating Chief Pickering on that honor. So.
Indeed we do.
Also, did want to mention, a week ago, Sunday, the time goes together, after the pool ceremony, there was another important ceremony that day. Andrew Clough, a member of the local Boy Scout troop, became an Eagle Scout, and it was he was the first Eagle Scout in Cape Elizabeth in the last 7 years. And Senator Amaro was there, I was there, and a number of other folks in the community. Some of you may remember his father, Larry Clough, was chairman of our zoning board for a number of years. Kathy Clough, his mother, a volunteer in the school system. It was a great honor for Andrew as well as for the Clough family. There's been some changes of late in the leadership of the companies of the fire department as well. As a result of the annual election process that they have in the different companies, we have two new captains. The new captain of Engine 1 is Jim Wilson, Jimmy Wilson. Jim is the son of former Fire Chief Chuck Wilson, and he's replacing Hap Williams, Bob Williams, who has been the captain there for a number of years and did a terrific job. At Engine 2, Mike Jordan, the longtime captain, completed his term as the captain, and Jerry Murray, a person well known to most everyone, was elected the captain of Engine 2 Company, and that I think we'll continue to see really fine leadership of Engine 2. So a lot of changes for the fire chief, working with two new captains at the same time, two of the different companies. At the same time, the wet team and the rescue unit held their elections, and Steve Jordan is continuing as the captain of the wet team, a position he's held for a number of years, and Evelyn Cox continues to do a very distinguished job as captain of the rescue unit. She was also reelected. Charlie Kennedy, although it's not part of the fire company, continues as the head of the fire police unit, which is tied in with the police department. So I wish all of them well, and I know I join Chief McGoldrick in saying we look forward to working with the leadership team and thanking all those who have stepped down from the leadership positions. Also wanted to mention that on Friday, Steve Parkhurst was in, who is the representative of the developer of the Cross Hill subdivision up on off Wells Road. And Steve brought in with him the conservation deed to the town for over 100 acres that is being donated as a result of that subdivision. So the land, if you think of Fort Williams being a little over 90 acres, the land that's being donated to the town as part of the Cross Hill development is in excess of the entire size of Fort Williams. It's a rather significant parcel. It also ties in the back with a parcel that came from, that the land trust has rights over from the Hinkle family. And next to that is the, in back of that, going, extending all the way near to the Sunny Young Farm, the corner of Fickett Street and Sawyer, is about another 60 acres that Alice Larea donated to the town. So if you add all of those parcels together, There's over 200 acres in conservation now, extending all the way from the intersection of Fickett Street and Sawyer all the way down to Wells Road, so it's really significant. That was conditionally accepted by the council, that deed, at the time the subdivision was first approved, and that will be, it'll be formally on your council agenda next month to formally accept that deed. In the meantime, we're holding the deed in the vault, awaiting to have it filed at the registry until next month's agenda. So I want to thank the planning board for all of their efforts on Cross Hill, the Conservation Commission, and Maureen and others that led to that donation, and particularly want to thank the developers, Doug Scheer, who's the anonymous developer whose name once in a while appears in the newspaper, in association with the development, as well as Steve Parkhurst, who is his representative. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I also wanted to mention one thing to the council that I had neglected to mention last month, and that is that the playground committee is ready to get themselves organized, but we need two members of the council, which we suggested that there be two council members on the playground committee. This is a committee that's going to be, I think, a short-term committee. It's a matter of looking at the land that we presently use for playgrounds and what we anticipate might be used in the future for playgrounds, and trying to coordinate it so that different organizations just don't move forward with playgrounds without a plan, an overall general plan for the community. So we need two members of the council. I won't ask for those now. I just want you to think about it between now and 30 seconds from now, maybe. All right. We're ready to, are there any items not on the agenda that members of the citizens out here would like to speak on? One, Mr. Walker.
Good evening. I'm John Walker, 21st Mills, Cape Elizabeth. I'm chair of the Cape Elizabeth Democrats, and just want to announce to the citizens of Cape Elizabeth that the primary is March 7th for election, and the Cape Elizabeth Democrats are holding their caucus on March 5th at 1:30 at the Cape Elizabeth Junior High School cafetorium. And if you are unenrolled and wish to participate, you can register to the Democratic Party by coming to Town Hall during regular hours, or there will be registration from 12:30 to 1:30 on caucus day.
Thank you very much.
Great part of our democracy, so thank you for this opportunity.
Thanks. Are there any items, other items, any other citizens that would like to speak of items not on the agenda? Hearing none, we'll move on to item number 73. I wanted to tell the members of the public that we have several items that are coming before us tonight, all of which by formality of the council rules must be, we need to set them for public hearing. So it's not that we're not acting on them, they are all going to public hearing, and we will be moving through them rather quickly, and we will give you explanation, and we hope that if you hear the ones that you're interested in, that you'll please remember to come to the public hearing so we have an opportunity to hear your voice. However, the first four items are rather connected, and I am going to let the manager speak on the connection of those four items. We, however, will be taking them up one at a time to set them for public hearing.
Point of order, should we approve the minutes of the meeting?
Oh, yes. Thank you very much.
And I would so move that the minutes be approved as written.
It's been moved and seconded that the regular council meetings of January 10th, 2000 be approved as written. Is there any more discussion? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed? None. Thank you very much. Thank you, Henry. You keep me on task.
Well,
at least in the right order.
That's my business, a nitpick.
Now the manager's going to speak about the four items, which we will again take up separately.
I think with your indulgence, Madam Chairman, I might do the first three.
Three,
I did say four early. It would be difficult for me to try to attach the fourth one to the first three. The town council has been looking at sewer rates for a couple of years now. Actually, they were last adjusted in 1996, and it's primarily based on a rate structure that's been in place since 1977, 1978. Right now, the multi-unit dwellings are based on a per-unit charge rather than a per-meter charge. They've been complaining about that, expressing concern for a number of years, and the town council has heard those complaints. And it seemed to be the consensus at the last council workshop that there ought to be an opportunity for the public to really comment on this through the, through a public hearing. This is a revised proposal from one earlier, and then the council would vote up or down the proposal. The first item, number 73, would be keeping the minimum at $26.50 per month for up to the first 100 cubic feet, and adjusting the incremental charge for 100, each additional 100 cubic feet of measured water usage from $3.82 per 100 to $4. It would also change all of the meters, all of the billing to a per meter rather than a per unit. So that would be the first public hearing proposed for 7:30 on March 15th at the Town Hall, a Wednesday, by the way. Item number 74 is the sewer charge for the school department. That's currently $63,000 annually. It's proposed to reduce it to $53,600 beginning July 1, 2000. And then thereafter, in 2001, it would be totally based on a meter fee. If it's felt that if the school department went to metering versus where they are now, that they would have a sewer bill closer to $35,000 rather than $63,000, thus saving the taxpayers' monies. The third item is consideration of a proposed amendment to the sewer connection fee, which would increase the connection fee from the current $2,700 per unit up to $3,000, an increase of $300. Again, that has not been changed since 1996. So those are three separate items, and they're all recommended for public hearing on March 15th at 7:30 here at the Town Hall.
Thank you. Henry?
I'd like to make a motion that those three items together be set for public hearing for March 15th, 2000.
Second.
I'd rather have them voted on separately.
Well, there's a motion that's second on the floor here. So we'll.
I'd be happy to withdraw the motion if the second is withdrawn and do them separately. That's all right.
Three of us. Which one?
All three of you.
We all agree.
All right. We'll take them up one at a time then.
I would move that item number 73 relating to the sewer user fees be set for a public hearing on March 15th, 2000. At 7:30 p.m.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded.
Is there any
30? At 7:30 p.m. Is there any more discussion on that item? All those in favor? Opposed? 5-2. It is now set for public hearing. Item number 74, consideration of a proposed amendment to the sewer fee for the Cape Elizabeth School Department that would, over 2 years, base the school's sewer charge on measured water charges. It is recommended this be set for public hearing. I'll have a motion.
I make a motion that item 74 relating to the school sewer fee be set for public hearing for March 15th, 2000 at 7:30 p.m.
Second.
I'm going to take turns over here in the second. It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? 6-1. Carol's here. Item number 75, consideration of a proposed amendment to the sewer connection fee, which would increase the connection fee from the current $2,700 to $3,000.
Again, I will make the motion that the item 75 relating to the sewer connection fee be set for public hearing on March 15th, 2000 at 7:30 p.m.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any more discussion on that item? All those in favor? Opposed? Unanimous. Thank you very much. Item number 76. Consideration of proposed amendments to the zoning ordinance recommending changes to the variance standards that would replace the, quote, undue hardship, unquote, standard with a, quote, practical difficulty standard, unquote, for variances outside of the Shoreland Performance Overlay District, and a recommendation that no variances be granted, which would reduce a setback to less than 10 feet, or the shortest non-conforming setback distance created by an existing building. I know this is very difficult to follow this when we're just reading it like this. There will be ample opportunity if you are concerned about setbacks and variance is granted, that you could appear for that meeting, which we'd be love to have you come and hear the comments that are made about that, because the council needs to hear from people before we can actually vote. We need the input from citizens. It is recommended that that be set for public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there anything, discussion?
Just one quick point, that if anyone wishes to see the exact language being proposed, it's available two ways. One is through the town office, and second, if you go into www.capeelizabeth.com, you go into the ordinance section. There's a section there for pending ordinances, and you can download it into Acrobat Reader and print it off.
Thank you.
I just hope that people will pay some very serious attention to this proposal. And I hope that the courier will do some serious reporting and look into the implications of the changes that this variance proposal would make. I think it would make a very serious impact on the character of our town neighborhoods. Many, many neighborhoods would be affected by this. So, I think that this definition would create much more lenient review of requests for variances, and I think the town would change a great deal. So I hope people pay some considerable attention.
Thank you very much, Carolyn. It is Jack.
Madam Chairman, I would ask that people also follow that. My concern is not quite the same as Carol's. I am concerned that the expectations are going to be raised, that a lot more can be done than can be done with this ordinance. And when people are being told no after this has been passed, that they will be attempting to sue us even more often. So I think I do want people to follow it also.
I hope it's clear to those watching at home that this is a very complicated and serious issue, and that you come to the public hearing. Is there any more discussion?
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I just wanted to kind of backtrack just a little bit to piggyback off what Carol said. And I would also like to see a fairly large turnout for the sewer issue. Although, you know, we have set the public hearing, I think that there are many, many of us who have grappled with that issue and have some concerns as to adjusting this, the fairness of it, et cetera. I would like to see people turn out for many of these issues, particularly the sewer issue, to give us some input as well.
Thank you. All in favor of setting number 76 for public hearing? Opposed? Item number 77, consideration for a proposed amendment to the zoning ordinance in the form of a chart which would adjust the front, side, and rear setbacks.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
I would like to have this item tabled indefinitely.
Second.
Seconded.
It's been seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? This is tabled indefinitely. There being no discussion on tabling issues. Number 78, consideration of proposed amendments to the comprehensive plan and the zoning ordinance relating to telecommunication towers and tower overlay districts. Remember, those of the public might remember that we have had a committee working these several months, that the federal government has asked that all towns be prepared to accept locations for towers. The simplest thing is, I guess, a cell phone towers that receive for that kind of communication, and they've been working hard on this issue, and this is also, I think, very important to the citizens of the community to come out for that public hearing to decide, or to give us input on where these locations should be. There is a plan forward which will have a map that will show you the areas that we recommend or that we will accept telephone cell towers. So this is also to be set for public hearing.
I move that we set a public hearing on this issue for March 15th, year 2000, at 7:30 p.m.
I'll second that.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
Yeah, I think that we ought to make the point that the ordinance committee, considered this and decided to pass it to the full council and the public hearing without recommendation.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Madam Chairwoman, I'd like to at least note at this point that the two site locations are where the current existing tower is off Wells and Spurwink Avenue, and at the transfer station. And I would also encourage people to attend this particular meeting as well. In the current ordinance, the way it's been presented, there are no limitations on the number of towers per acre, and I'm not sure if that's something that we should be addressing. I would like to see that done, and would certainly welcome some public input on that.
I think that was our thinking.
Is there any more discussion on this item? Hearing none, all those in favor? Opposed? It's unanimous. Item number 79, consideration of a recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Committee Commission recommending group use policy for Fort Williams Park. This is a very lengthy document that they've worked very hard to come up with the wording so that there are some very understandable rules and regulations regarding the use of the fort, the rental of equipment at the fort and buildings at the fort, and we are setting this for public hearing. We have with the recommendation of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee.
I move that that be set for public hearing on March 15th, 2000 at 7:30
p.m.
Looks like a long night on public hearing.
Yeah, it's going to be a long night. Any more discussion?
Is it appropriate to say, this is the first time we're seeing this from the Fort Williams Committee, and since the chair is here, I was just wondering whether it would be appropriate to ask any questions.
Sure.
Where's Dan?
Ken?
I guess the one that I was wondering about the implications of was the one on school outings. I mean, that seems like it could possibly balloon into quite a few busloads of kids all at one time. And
we included that because it came to our attention that unannounced various school districts from around the greater Portland area would just show up in Fort Williams. Mm-hmm. And it created quite a problem for the Rangers to try to guide them in one spot, or they came in expecting to get the picnic shelter and the picnic shelter was rented and then they sort of run wild. And when we looked at the group use policy, there wasn't anything specific in there to allow either the ranger or the town manager or even Public Works to identify and to notify various school districts around town that it's not come one, come all, that we need to have something, some policy written down. So we addressed that issue, and it hasn't been a major problem, but it is a concern as we looked at all the different use requests that come in, the unannounced people that show up. So we wanted to at least address that issue. And I don't think there's been any problem with our own use, the local school of Fort Williams, and that's never been a problem. But it seemed to be growing year after year, especially as we investigated with the Rangers and Public Works, that more and more schools from the greater area, Portland area, just showing up. And it started out as a half a busload, then one busload, and then, you know, a couple schools started showing up the same day. So our intent is that if it's passed, that maybe either the town clerk or the town manager can notify their various school districts that if you intend on using Fort Williams, you really need to get our approval ahead of time, either in writing to the town manager or Public Works. We need to know what's going on there on an official basis if we're expecting 50 or 100 people to come without us knowing. And it's really been a hardship for the Rangers. And we also tried to address that, and what do you do with people if there's a large group that shows up and the picnic shelter is taken already? Yeah. So we're working on designating two or three other areas to try to help the town, the Rangers in the park, to be able to peacefully and friendly guide those groups that have taken over certain areas which are not for reservation and move them to another part of the area. And we hope to do that, at least give the Ranger the power to do that on an ad needed basis if a bus or two shows up unannounced.
And we just on that point, if I might, we had at least one instance I know of 8 buses from one school system all come the same day without any notice at all. And it was, and then to this was a couple of years back, we had given permission to the Coast Guard that day to do some very necessary movement of equipment out to one of the lighthouses. And we got phone calls late that afternoon how scared the kids were and how could we have allowed the helicopter there when the kids were coming. And you know, we had to kindly explain to these parents that were very upset the Coast Guard had asked for permission and their school system hadn't. And you know, had we known the kids were coming, we would have made other precautions and you know, would have worked with the teachers to let them know they wouldn't be in that area. but it is good for us to know when these are coming so that we don't end up with three school systems bringing 8 buses on the same day, which is...
And it was never really identified in the old group use policy as what the ranger should do or even what Public Works Department should do when they get a request, two requests like that, because there wasn't anything in writing. So hopefully, if approved, we'll be able to notify all the school districts somehow that if you're planning on coming to Fort Williams, you know, welcome, but you have to let us know ahead of time. Especially when you get around to April, May, and June, you want to take class outings, and everybody wants to graduate the same day. And
I was going to ask if you're able to write notifications to the schools. I know they come from, I mean, they come from far away, some of these schools. I don't know how far up you have to notify them.
I've seen buses down there from 5 counties, so.
Wow.
Yeah.
I don't know how you'll do the notification, but it seems appropriate. They should let us know.
The staff does it, the commission.
Well, do they?
Yeah.
Okay.
I'm just wondering, I mean, maybe the public hearing is the more appropriate time, but do school bus loads go to Light State Park and Crescent Beach State Park? I mean, I wonder. I mean, it still seems like it could, we could have, how many grades actually would you have from each school that, I mean, I realize you'd say limiting it to one, to 5 bus loads, but you also say that all school groups exceeding 1 full-size bus load. So it seems that 1 full-size bus load could come without getting permission. I mean, as long as they're under 1 bus load.
It came to, you know, where do you draw the line? And if we don't want to say 15 kids are okay, but 16 aren't. And 1 bus is sort of informal. It's not a lot of children. They could certainly have their run of the park and not come across anybody else. But once you cross that threshold, then it's like this, it takes planning to put 2 buses together. And you're talking about 30, 40, 50 people, and that started to get, you know, 2 bus loads we can handle, but if you pick a nice weekday and 2 or 3 school systems have the same idea, then that's where we run into troubles in the past. So I think we just drew the line. There wasn't any magical number about 30 children and 2 or 3 teachers, but I don't want to start getting to, you know, we'll allow 1.5 bus loads, and you can't allow 3 or 4, so we pretty much came to consensus on that figure.
But if bus loads of kids go to Crescent Beach or Two Lights, do they pay a fee, but we wouldn't be charging a fee?
I don't know the answer to that. We do not investigate use of other state-run parks or federal parks. We are an open park. We don't charge fees, and I think we addressed that issue already.
Thank you.
We're really looking for the other school districts to just, you know, give us a courtesy call, which is really what it amounts to. It's no major problem, but I think if we don't let them know that, hey, we do have a updated group use policy and please call us, just the notification from us alone should be enough that the superintendent of the schools that are coming here should call Bob Malley or call someone to give us a heads up, just to warn the rangers. And so we'll know how many people are coming. If it's 50 or 60 people coming and it crosses that 50 threshold, then we may want to guide them to the 2 or 3 new areas where they can set up picnic tables or we can set aside that they don't take over the beach, for example. And that was the biggest point of contention, is that unofficial groups would come in or school groups would come in and take over the 5 or 6 picnic benches by the beach area, and no one else had access to the beach that day because there's 30, 40 kids running around. So our intention is to get a group like that if we know they're coming, and if there's activity in the park that day, to allow the ranger the flexibility to move them a little bit away from where the average people tend to congregate and walk, and have a larger group a little bit off of center. And we can't do that. We can't give them the power unless we know they're coming. Or I should say, if we knew they're coming in advance, we could really help them out ahead of time rather than just unload the bus and see you in 2 hours.
Thanks, Paul. Any more questions?
Not a question, but I just wanted to congratulate Paul on being named chair. As many of you know, he lives across from the park and on a consistent and daily basis knows what's going on there and the concerns and issues, and I think he will lead this organization, this group, very well. I have every confidence that he'll do an outstanding job, so congratulations.
Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. Is there any more discussion on this item? It's been moved and seconded this item be set for public hearing. All those in favor? Opposed? None, hearing none. Item number 80, consideration of a report from the Enhanced 911 Addressing Committee recommending the designation of certain street names. We could have them, one of them.
I'll do a brief intro, and there's also two members of the committee here.
Right.
Let me briefly go over them. There's six numbers at the very far end of Eastfield Road, out down on the dirt section. It's proposed to change that to Long Point Lane, those properties, and this was in discussion with the owners. Greenview Drive was, on the last list, came somehow forward as Greenview Drib. obviously, they don't want to live on a drive, they want to live on a drive. Tree Vista Lane, it had been agreed to prior to when this was voted on at the last meeting, that would become a remain 882 Shore Road. For whatever reason, it didn't make the final list. Remember, that first list was quite long. Homefield Lane, the Sprague's Corporation would like that name Fieldways Lane in order to adhere to what's on the registered plan of the Sprague Corporation. Chancellor Gardens wants to remain One Chancellor Drive for a while. They want to remain 78 Scott Dyer Road instead of becoming One Chancellor Drive. They may have to change at a later date that at least gets them through their initial marketing period and some major issues they have with some investments they've made in terms of their marketing effort. And finally, the circle in front of the Keeper's Quarters is proposed to be Captain Strout Circle. Number 12 in the Portland Headlight property would be 12 Captain Strout Circle. Captain Strout, there were three or four Captain Strouts who were lighthouse keepers for about 60 years, Cape Elizabeth natives, just a tradition of many well-known, and they are the most well-known lighthouse keepers, and it seemed to be a nice way to remember them. And we had several other alternatives that were dancing around, and Cheryl really liked that one, Captain Strout. The two chiefs have worked on this quite a bit, along with Bob Consul, our assessor. You also had an issue, an issue involving Robinson Cove Road or Mars Cove Lane. Back in November, the council did vote for Robinson Cove Road, so that is what remains in place, until someone comes forward with a proposal to change it. And there may be still some discussion on that. I don't anticipate anyone's going to come forward this evening to propose to change Robinson Cove Road to Mars Cove Lane, but that still does remain an open issue and could come back to you at some later date. But the committee is here to answer any questions you may have, but they do recommend those items that are on the list. And again, Robinson Cove Lane remains that until Robinson Cove Road remains that until the council entertains another proposal.
Move we accept the recommendations from the committee.
I'll second that.
I did have a question.
Yeah. Yes.
I talked to the only member of the committee who's not here, Bob Consul, of course, regarding Delano Park. Has there been anything we've been able to do for the people of Delano Park?
We early on in this process, we received a petition from, every resident of Delano Park. We were confronted by a couple of issues down there. If we had gone strictly by the protocol recommended by the state, we would have changed all of the names of each of the entrances in Delano Park. We tried to mitigate the impact of that, and of course, that was recommended by the council early on in the ordinance-making process. And what we did was kept the entrances as they were, but adjusted everyone's house number so that they coincided with the entrance, like entrance one would be 100 series, 200 series, 300 series, etc. So we have not managed to agree with their keeping the same street numbers they have. However, we did manage to keep the entrance number. So long way around your question is we haven't mitigated that to their satisfaction.
Okay, thank you.
All right, it's been moved and seconded. Is there any more discussion?
Thank you. I just would hope that we could sort of separate these two issues. I have a list in front of me of six street names, and it seems to me that we're voting on that, but then there is also this other issue on the side about Robinson Cove Road and Mars Cove Lane, which it should be, and I would just like to make it real clear that we're voting specifically on the six street names that Mike listed a few minutes ago, because I think the issues should be dealt with separately.
The motion was to accept the recommendations, and the recommendations are just on this sheet at this point. The smaller texts were just from the manager's office explaining what was happening, so I don't think we need to do anything official on that, other than maybe strike it out on our own reports here that it wasn't talked about.
So your motion was just on the six street names that are on this addendum list?
Right.
The other piece that needs to be part of the motion is the effective date. Proposed for September 1, 2000.
May I add that to my motion then, be effective on September 1?
Second.
Yeah. Is that all the, because didn't we vote to make it effective on another date the first time around?
Yes, I think I can clear that, Councilman McGinty. We were originally advised by the Postal Service, and this is back last fall, they would need between 6 and 8 weeks to implement the address changes and notify the residents. Bob Consul spoke with those folks last week, and so much of this project we have very little to do with, or we have to subscribe to other state agencies and other federal agencies, and the post office is one of them. They have been inundated, of course, by these address changes around Greater Portland, and they advised us that they were looking at a August or September date to be prepared to make these address notifications. So while we have a public forum today, and of course we're going to be putting some pieces in the Cape Courier, we're going to meet with the town manager tomorrow to discuss how we're going to notify people immediately of the proposed date. But the September 1st date that you see in the proposal is what is being driven by the post office. We're prepared to make these public at this time, but I want to caution anyone who has received a notification that their address will be changing not to use that address until they're officially notified through the post office sometime late summer, early fall.
So is it better not to put a date determined on our motion?
I think a September date would be a safe date, and then again, that we're being advised by the Postal Service that would be appropriate. And keep in mind that this 911 system is supposed to be in place by July, as far as the mechanics of the system. So we'll have to see how that plays out. I'm not necessarily confident that that's going to happen. They're starting in Kittery and moving easterly, so we're just going to have to wait to see how that that cutover takes place in other communities.
All right. Does the motion reflect the date?
I can reflect the date of no later than September. Does that make it easier for you? September 1.
The clarification I want, though, just what you said, we're voting on these six addresses, but we need to make it for all of the addresses effective.
That's what the note says, all
right.
Street names.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, but the motion was, yeah. He tried to clarify to make the motion only for the six, so
right.
We'll make it clear it's for all of them. Right.
For all,
right.
All changes to date.
Except
we're not addressing the other ones.
Okay. All right. Is that clear to the clerk? What we're doing. Doesn't want it to be written.
Just that it'd be less of any doubt. I did speak with the Postal Service following up on Bob Consul's conversation with them, and they indicated absolutely no problem with the September 1 date, and particularly that if that council set that, they would guarantee overnight delivery. They'd guarantee that they would meet that deadline.
All right. Yes, Councilor Fritz.
I became aware that the rescue unit had trouble locating somebody in my neighborhood because the person was giving their new address instead of their old address. And since we're not very clearly marked anyway. But when should people be using their new addresses for rescue purposes and police and fire?
All of these new addresses will be cut over September 1st.
So that's
September. On or about that date. They should wait to get notification from the Postal Service. That triggers this whole process, okay. As far as the public's concerned.
You could make that clear in the courier.
Absolutely.
Stuff about that.
Part of tomorrow's meeting is we will be doing a mailing to everyone explaining the process, explaining what they need to start thinking about doing, and the whole way that it will work for them. So.
And when.
So everyone will be getting a letter. It's a couple of residents who own properties, don't live in town, they don't see the courier. We want to make sure if it's something as important as this, we reach everyone.
All right. Is there any more discussion on, is it clear to everybody, we're voting on all the previous ones that came before us, the recommendations, plus these last six that are listed on this paper? All right, all those in favor?
I amend my second to go along with Counselor Roberts' motion.
We had a previous recommendation of a zillion names and numbers.
Right.
So we're voting now.
Including a vote for Robinson, so that vote happened.
That was in November.
In November.
So, but it's the sense of the council that you don't want to do that one, because there is some ongoing debate on that, is that correct?
My understanding was that we were going to just move forward, and what had been accepted as of the November meeting has been accepted, and then add these six new addresses onto it, but not making any changes to anything we previously agreed to.
Other than to confirm the September 1 date?
Yes, other than the September 1 date.
But also with the understanding that, at least according to this note, there is still some controversy, maybe too strong a word, but there's an ongoing discussion about Mars Cove Lane versus Robinson Cove Road, and that discussion is still being discussed by the property owners who have an interest in it. Is that correct? So we're not voting on that issue at this point, right? Right.
I just want to make sure everybody understands then that we're voting on, as I understand what the council's saying, we're voting on all the roads that have come before us with the exception of the Robinson Cove / Mars Cove Lane.
No.
No.
No. May I give it a try, Penny?
Well, yeah, because I'm going to, okay.
Yeah. This evening, you're voting on the six new street names, as I understand the motion. And you're moving as part of that, that occur, and that it be effective September 1, 2000. You're also voting that all of the street numbering, which you haven't seen at all, which is part of an address, would be effective September 1, 2000. Mm-hmm. You're also voting that anything you previously voted for, you're not revisiting it with bias. You're simply revisiting it to say, yes, that list is September 1 as well.
It's just the date.
Just the date. You're not changing anything on that list. And it is with the understanding that you still may revisit the issue of Robinson Cove Road name that was previously designated.
Okay.
Correct. That would be reflected.
Well, then I think that I need to make a little bit clear what I guess I misunderstood for this evening. I received a call from
Mrs. Dunham,
who is the other person who lives on that same road that we're discussing here, the Robinson / Mars Cove Road, because I had known ahead of time that this road discussion was coming up tonight. But she called, and I guess she called some other counselors too, to say that she and the Strouts, who are having this discussion, are going to, she explained to me that they were going to work out the potential for some other three names, or two or three names, but neither one of these names. So I said to myself, well, okay, we'll eliminate this from discussion tonight until they do what they're going to do, and we'll vote on all the other ones. So, but she said to me, but because we're going to have an ongoing discussion, we will not come to the council meeting tonight because we're going to meet with the Strouts and have a future discussion. So I see that the Strouts are here, and I'm happy to have the Strouts speak, but the other couple is not here. So the council may decide what they're going to do. Yes, Frank.
Hi, I'm Frank Strout. I live at 1184 Shore Road. And I own the road that has been designated Robinson Cove Road. It was back in November that the name was approved as Robinson Cove Road. And I received a call from the Dunhams. Well, actually, I called the Dunhams because I had heard that they were very upset that the name was Robinson Cove Road. So I explained to them that I was the one that came up with the name that had been approved, and that if they and the Partridges could come up with a different name, that I would be willing to sit down and discuss it with them. And that was the last time we had talked about it. It was November. I received a call last night from Sandy Dunham. She asked if I would be willing to sit down and come up with some other names for the road. We discussed it for briefly, and I said, Sandy, I've been through this for a long time now. I'm tired of the issue. I would give it some thought, but that I really wanted to try to stick with Robinson Cove Road. It means a lot to me, it means a lot to my family. We've owned that property for 350 years. You've all read the letters that have been sent to you. At the end of the conversation, Sandy had said that that she would be making her presentation tonight. I really don't want to get into one of these he said, she said things. It's just, it's not going to go anywhere. But anyways, that was the last that I knew of the discussion until I came here tonight and found that...
Right, I assumed it wouldn't be on, yeah.
Can I answer any questions on it?
So, as I understand it, you are not planning on having a further discussion with Mrs. Dunham? I'm just confused, because mm-hmm. when I had spoken with, the latest word I had heard was that she was planning on sitting down with you and discussing new names, but from what you just said, I'm not sure. Is that your plan also?
It was not my plan.
Pardon me?
It was not my plan. We had talked about the possibility of doing that. I said that I would think about it. I'd give it some consideration. When I went back and talked to my family about it, they really were very interested in keeping me with Robinson Cove Road.
So did you call Mrs. Dunham and let her
know? I did not. The last thing we talked about was that she'd be making her presentation here tonight. And that was the last I knew of it until I came here this evening.
Yes.
Actually, the comment is through the chair. I'm not real comfortable in having street names being discussed with the council anyway. That's the committee's charge. And the motion tonight, there's nothing to preclude either the Robinsons or the Dunhams from continuing to work with the committee and have the committee come forward with that recommendation. But I don't believe this council was ever intended to sit here and try to be the arbiter between people who wanted different name changes. That's why we have that committee.
Well, that is true, unless they were not able to come to a conclusion that was satisfactory to two people, then it was going to come before the council. We'd hope that the committee could continue to be a buffer right to the bitter end, but it is one before us now, and we will be taking this one up, I believe. Councilor Watson.
Madam Chair, I guess this is directed again to you. My concern is that we're hearing from the Dunhams, we're hearing from the Strouts, but there is another group of people, the Partridges,
That's
who we're
right.
not hearing from.
That's right.
And from my view, I would feel that the majority should rule, and that if you couldn't come unanimously to a decision, that the majority of those parties, three parties, come to a decision on the name of the road. But I also agree with Councillor Roberts that it's really not our responsibility. I mean, I think Chief Pickering and Consul and Chief McGoldrick to work with these people, you know, if they can come to some agreement. And I understand that it has not been able to come to agreement for some time now, and I'm sure that is extremely frustrating. But I would like to see the parties who are most impacted be able to come to terms and make a decision versus having, you know, seven councillors who don't have any vested interest per se in coming to that decision. I think it would behoove the Dunhams and you and the Partridges to sit down as best you can, and you all have a vested interest, and we don't. We don't live on that road, and we don't have the history that you do, and I can appreciate your desire to have Robinson Cove Road. But, you know, we need to come to some agreement, and I think that our committee of McGoldrick and Pickering and Consul have done a very good job so far, and it's too bad that we have this issue before us. And I'd like to see you all sit down again, if you could, and come up with something that would work for all of you. Maybe it's just more elaborating on why Robinson Cove Road is the best choice. I don't know.
Well, I guess then where we were a few minutes ago, which was voting on the names with the exception of the last road that is under discussion. Yeah. We're not accepting either Mars or Robinson tonight. Is that correct?
I have to change the motion.
I think that Robinson was already Cove was already accepted
in November
by us in November.
Mm-hmm.
By a town council vote as part of that whole long list. So I think it sort of is going to remain Robinson Cove. Although I must admit that the list that I got in pre-work for the November meeting
had Mars Cove Road, and that's what I believed I was voting on. I did not understand that it was Robinson Cove Road until after the meeting, because a list was handed to us at the meeting, so. But that's neither here nor there. We were voting on a whole long list. I too, like Councilor Watson, would like to see the parties involved come to a conclusion on this. As I understand it, the only people whose address will be changed by whatever this street name comes out to be is the Dunhams, because I believe that the Strouts, your address is Shore Road, is that correct?
Yes.
And the Partridges, I believe, have a Shore Road address.
That's correct.
So the only people whose address will be affected by this are the Dunhams. So whether it's the three people, I agree, it'd be good to get the three people together, because I, as a member of the council, don't want to get involved in picking people's street names. But unfortunately, I think we are on the hook eventually if the people can't, the individuals involved can't come to an agreement, so according to the regulation of the town.
Just wanted to clarify two issues. One is that if this issue is to be revisited, you know, there's three ways it gets on an agenda. Mm-hmm. One is for a council member to request to come on an agenda. Mm-hmm. Two is for a citizen to request to come on the agenda. And three is the addressing committee. It will not come back on an agenda unless one of those three things happens. So that's what it would take in order to revisit anything but Robinson Cove Road. So either the Dunhams would, or someone else would need to come forward, or the committee would need to go forward, or councilor would ask for it. The second thing I wanted to clarify through the chief, since it's been mentioned a couple times, the Partridges, they have a Shore Road address.
The Partridges right now would have a Robinson Cove Road address unless they elected, the house is under construction, as many of you know, unless they elected to put a separate driveway to Shore Road. And that is their option, and they were considering that the last time I talked to them.
So their address is sort of undetermined at the moment.
That's correct. And perhaps I should give you a little history. The addressing committee originally recommended Mars Cove Road. Uh-huh. And, of course, everyone that was notified of a potential address change got that notification in the mail, and we entertained any request for reconsideration. Mr. Strout requested reconsideration and recommended Robinson Cove Road, which we agreed with. So we'd reversed ourselves one time. Mm-hmm. Then we got calls from, as happened a few times, as a matter of fact, throughout this project, we got calls from other individuals on the road, purely for the sake of efficiency, so that we wouldn't keep reversing ourselves. Our final recommendation to the council was Robinson Cove Road. We have no personal interest one way or the other what this is. We were hoping again that the parties could come to terms with this, and it's been battered back and forth for a couple, 3 months. But as has already been mentioned this evening, unless we bring it forward or one of the individuals involved in the street bring it forward, that's our final recommendation at this point.
So the change from Mars, the committee's change from Mars Cove to Robinson Cove was made after discussion with the Strouts and no one else?
That's correct.
Okay, so the Dunhams weren't privy to that discussion.
They might have been indirectly through this process, but I think we agreed with Mr. Strauss' recommendation on it for the reasons he's indicated here tonight.
Councilor Fritz.
How were other roads handled that had, say, three or so people on them that would change, or even two?
Right.
I mean, were they to come up with a new name?
Well, we learned very quickly that you know, we didn't take the first recommendation that came to us, and probably about the beginning of December, if there were anyone on that particular street asked for reconsideration, we notified everybody on the street and said, we need a consensus here, or we need actually a 100% agreement on it, and that solved a lot of problems.
Mm-hmm.
This issue was early on in the process, unfortunately.
So the others, any other sort of controversial names were finally determined by consensus on the street by the individuals?
Yes.
So this is the only instance where there wasn't consensus that you can think of?
When there was a dispute about a name.
When there was a dispute.
There was still some dissatisfaction period.
Yes, but I mean a dispute about the name. Okay. Thank you.
Can I just clarify two points? One is Robinson Cove Road is a private road. The people, the other parties that use the road have a right-of-way over it. I, in fact, own it. And the second point is that the Dunhams live in Yarmouth. This does not change their street address. Their street address still remains, or their residential address still remains Yarmouth. They hope to move here someday, and to tell you the truth, I hope they do. Our kids get along great, and they are very good friends. But this is something in the future. If they do never move here, and they change the name, I just don't see that that's fair.
I don't think that has anything to do with it. I mean, we're naming the physical road, not their address. It's the physical road that we have to deal with.
Correct.
And they own the property, right?
They own the property. They own the property at the end of the road that I own. But I think that the contention is that we are changing their address, or there will be a change of address. And in fact, the way I see it, it's not a change of address.
I would agree with Councillor Fritz. I think it does change their address. It may not be their principal place of residence, but there are plenty of people in town who have summer residences here or several residences. And it's the address of that particular home, so that property.
Does the council feel that they... I can only tell you what I know, which may or may not be true, and that is that in my conversation with Mrs. Dunham, I asked her, I couldn't actually remember what the road was in November when we looked at this the first time, because I know it was an ongoing dispute. I asked her when she called, are you planning to come to the meeting? She said, no, I'm planning a presentation, but I'm not going to be coming tonight because you don't have to take it up tonight because we're all going to be sitting down to meet. So I said, okay, fine. I actually scratched it off of my agenda, that particular road. It is my understanding, and I do not know if this is true, but maybe the committee can help, and that is that when this became from Mars Road back, and then changed from Mars Road to Robinson Road, that they did not get the notice at the same time because they don't yet live in Cape Elizabeth, and so they missed that time of appeal. I mean, when they heard about it, that the discussion you'd already had with Mr. Stratton had already gone on?
We never, you know, we were always very flexible on timelines as far as when the cutoff was, when somebody could appeal. We have met both with the Partridges and the Dunhams, and the Dunhams several occasions, along with having several telephone conversations. So this has been in the mix for quite a while, mm-hmm. even though, you know, again, because of efficiency, our final recommendation was Robinson Cove Road. So we haven't had a chance to discuss alternatives. In fact, the manager met with one or two of the parties in an attempt to mitigate this. That's why we felt that this was going to come before the council tonight, because the Dunhams wanted to make the case for Myers Cove Road. And at this point, by ordinance, it would be the council's call. We've made our final recommendation. If you want to overrule us and pick another street name, that's fine. But that's the protocol under the ordinance, is the council will rule on anything that we cannot mitigate.
Is it my understanding that nobody lives on this road?
Nobody lives in this road.
Why are we, why are we even discussing this, if you ask me? I mean, it doesn't make any sense if nobody lives on this road.
Yeah.
There are people.
Yeah, well, yeah, but that's, yeah. But well, the Partridges have a Shore Road address. Ms. Stroud has a Shore Road address.
They do own the some rent. There. The Gunners rent their property. There are people that live there.
Oh, there are people. Mm-hmm. Okay, all right.
Madam Chairwoman.
Yes.
I'd like to restate what my motion was, make sure we're clear on that, and then move the question.
Mm-hmm.
My recommendation was that we accept the names on this sheet, the six names, accept those. We include all of the addresses that we previously had accepted for September 1 last date. This in no way precludes anybody from going back to that committee and asking for a name change. They have plenty of, between now and September, they've got plenty of time to do that. So having said that, I would ask to move the question.
To the extent that my second is requires a change, I will amend it to comply with the Councillor Roberts' motion.
Madam Chair, recognizing that Councillor Roberts has moved the question,
right.
Could I just add one thing and see if Councillor Roberts would be willing to attach this to his motion? Since the Dunhams live in Yarmouth, and are not necessarily privy to our television station or necessarily can easily get to these meetings. I would like to have a letter sent to them addressing how, what steps they could take if they're not happy with Robinson Cove Road, a letter addressing the three ways that this issue could be brought to the council. Just giving them the information that they need to know what appeal process, if any, they have.
Well, the question has actually been moved, and that would be an addition to the question. We have to respond, first of all, either vote yay or no to the question.
Okay.
And then if you vote yay, it's over. If you vote no, then you can add your thing. So the question is now on the floor, as Councillor Roberts put it. Okay. All those in favor?
As far as Councillor Watson's concerned, I would like to have the council instruct the town manager to take care of that and notify the Dunhams of what the procedures are. I don't think you need a vote on that.
Okay.
I think it should also include that we have encouraged people who live on a particular road to get together and figure out a consensus on what the road name ought to be. And I hope that they would do that.
You're the only people who live on that road, aren't you?
Yes. Okay. We are now on item number 81. Consideration of conditional acceptance of a revised parcel of land that is part of the Hemlock Hills subdivision. This did come before us once before, and we're going to have a report. Are we going to have a report?
Yeah, I'll bring you to the point and then have Mr. Fitzpatrick speak. You might, Madam Chairman.
All right.
This originally came to the council. You agreed to accept a smaller parcel. This subsequently went to Superior Court in terms of some of the neighbors challenging the subdivision. And Mr. Fitzpatrick has amended the subdivision plans and going through the planning board process. It's coming up again at the planning board tomorrow night.
Yes.
For final approval, and in dotting the I and crossing the T, since this is a substantive change from your earlier roughly 11,000 square feet up to 17,000 square feet, it would be good for the council to take a look at it. And I think this is just as valuable as the 11,000 was in terms of providing good connections to the neighborhood, Cape Woods, and open space. So Joel's here to show you where the lot is and explain it.
Yeah, my name is Joel Fitzpatrick of Fitzpatrick Associates. We are the developers of the Hemlock Hill subdivision, as Mr. McGovern stated. The previous lot was 11,780 square feet. We are increasing that to 17,177. It previously was a little line like that. We're adding this little piece right here.
So we're going from 11,000 to 17.
Right.
Okay. Are there any questions of Mr. Councilor Roberts?
Joel, across the street there, is that a public way at all to connect anything else going towards Oakhurst?
Yes, that was part of the planning board approvals of last April. We have this is the town-owned land. We have a easement through this 50-foot area here. It's shaded to Oakhurst.
Okay, I thought so, but the map we had in the packet was not very, was really hard to read it and see it.
Right, yes, that's going to be a deeded right-of-way through Lot 9 and Lot 8 for public access.
Okay, great, thank you.
I have a question, not for Mr. Fitzpatrick, but has anyone from the town planning board or the planning office or the town planner expressed any concern about this particular issue, accepting this revised parcel of land?
No concerns have been expressed at any level, anywhere.
Okay.
Either by abutters or by the planning board or by the planner. It's all felt that it's in keeping with providing good pedestrian connection ways, particularly between the Cape Wood condominiums and Oakhurst Road, so people don't have to walk out on that hill on Oakhurst and the narrow section of Mitchell there.
Councilor McGinty.
That was going to be my question. It does connect up Cape Woods. That
yes.
does back up,
yes.
right up against it.
Councilor Fritz.
And this parcel is not, I mean, is it wet or
It's actually pretty high. It's got a little brook stream running through it, but the banks are actually high, and it's a nice dry piece.
So it's not
right.
Mr. wetland that
no,
people
no.
can't actually use as open space?
No, the wetland here is this dotted line, this little dotted line right here. And you can see that there is no wetland mapped out. We had a high-intensity soil survey done on this property, and this is the only wetland on this whole piece of land in this RP2 wetland.
Councilor McGinty.
I move that we accept the revised parcel of land that's part of the Hemlock Hill subdivision.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? None?
It's a conditional approval, as I understand it.
I understood the motion to be acceptance, which is fine, because we're about to be offered this deed anyway.
Yes.
Yeah, I think if the council doesn't mind the acceptance.
I can change my motion to conditional. Does it make?
I can second that as well.
Okay.
Well, I guess maybe the concern is more conditional approval of the road, because we have to approve it then.
There's no change in that. You did
the road's the same. It's just the size of the lot.
The size of this lot. Part of this lot was originally going to become part of another lot here, and instead it's remaining as part of this.
Yes.
It doesn't affect the road at all.
Which is the town.
You still need to actually accept the road once it's built, yes.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay. We all set?
Yeah.
We voted? Did we vote?
Yes.
We did?
Thank you.
It's my
thank
boss.
You.
I can't remember what I did 2 minutes ago. Yeah, I have your name down here. Item number 82, consideration of report from the Appointments Committee recommending a citizen to serve as a trustee of the Thomas Memorial Library. Councilor Swift-Cayetta.
Yes, I just wanted to let the public know that we had recently had a resignation from this board, the Thomas Memorial Library. The Appointments Committee had interviewed Mr. Kinsley and found him an excellent candidate, and so we unanimously recommended him to serve as a new trustee for Thomas Memorial.
That's a motion.
And so I'd like to move that.
I'll second it.
I'd like to move that, all the above.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? None. Motion carries. Item number 83, consideration of a quick claim deed for property located at 19 Cottage Farms Road. You want to do that?
Yes, thank you.
Town clerk.
Thank you. On January 12th, the town foreclosed on a property located at 19 Cottage Farms Road for failure to pay a sewer lien that was filed some 18 months ago. Interesting enough on this item is that there was, in fact, a mortgage holder, People's Heritage Bank. They had been notified, as the law requires. Basically, with my conversations from People's, I think that they dropped the ball in terms of paying before this foreclosure took place, which is not something that mortgage holders generally like to have happen, but the fact remains that the lien did lapse. So People's has provided the town with a check of over $2,700 that pays about four tax liens, I believe, plus the second half of the real estate taxes, and the Portland Water District has also been satisfied to date, at least, with any past due sewer to them. So this is an order this evening for the council to authorize a manager to sign a quick claim deed back to Charles and Catherine Rich for property located at 19 Cottage Farms Road.
Thank you. Council, discussion or motion?
Yeah.
So moved.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that we authorize the town manager to sign a quick claim deed on the property at 19 Cottage Farms Road. Discussion.
I have a question on that. It goes back to the people who had the property subject to the mortgage, right? Now, has the lien wiped out the mortgage so the people get the property back without a mortgage?
In terms of People's, do you mean?
No, in terms of the Riches.
The Riches are the previous property owners of record, so
right.
The quick claim will go back immediately to them.
To them?
Yeah. Yeah, and we are just releasing our rights to the liens that are on file at the registry.
But you say the lien had ripened into title.
The lien had ripened, so the course of action for the council is once everything is paid to assign a quick claim deed.
Just a quick claim deed.
Yeah, we. It had ripened into foreclosure, Counselor. We had not gone through the process of quieting the title. So therefore, the attachments were still associated with the property. Yes, including the mortgage. We will simply quit claim our interest back to the original party owner, and then therefore, all of those, whatever other attachments might be on the property, would be a matter to be resolved by this party and by any of the parties with attachments.
I still have a concern about the foreclosure. As I understood what you said, the payment was made after the foreclosure ripened into title.
After the foreclosure, and you know, you used the term ripened into title. I'm trying to disassociate myself with those comments of yours simply because I think there is a difference, and we've always treated it, although you're an attorney, and I hesitate to debate the issue with you, former district attorney, in fact.
Crime fighter, not as
but, you know, titles aren't, particularly titles with attachments, aren't worth much unless you go through the process of quieting the title.
Sure.
And truly making it totally ripe. And we hadn't gone through that ripening process.
I understand it wouldn't.
Like fruit.
Sure, yeah. Fruit.
Councilor Roberts.
Yeah, Madam Chairwoman. Is anyone here from the Riches? No. My only concern would be that giving the title back to the Riches, that the bank could then take the property if they weren't happy with the fact that the bills hadn't gotten paid in the first place. And I'm assuming that that's not happening, that once the title goes back to the property, the Riches, that the bank won't, in fact, foreclose on them once they've got it back in their hands.
The Riches have been notified by mail with this, and they were invited to come this evening. I have not heard from them. They have chosen, for whatever reason, not to pick up several certified mails that go to them about impending foreclosures, liens, and so forth. And I'm not sure that it's up to us, if you will, of what Peoples decides.
No, I'm going to vote for it, but I'm just curious
mortgage.
Whether we're giving it back to the Riches or
we're giving
it back
to the Riches, and
the
then how Peoples gets theirs back is up to them. Mm-hmm. I really don't know how their mortgage is written, what the fine print might be, you know, for the consequences, if you will, if something like that.
Yeah, that's what I was getting at.
Yeah.
All those in favor? Opposed? None. Thank you. Item number 84, review of a request from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission for approval of the use of Fort Williams Park on June 17th, 2000, with a rain date of June 24th, 2000, for the 19th Annual Family Fun Day.
I'd move approval of that.
I'll second.
It's been moved and seconded that the date of June 17th, 2000 be approved for the date of the Family Fun Day with its rain date of June 24th. All those in favor?
Question on...
Any more discussion?
Just insurance. Liability insurance. Is this covered under a town blanket policy?
It's Family Fun Day is a town event. And
event.
It's covered.
And is that we have at least $300,000 covered?
Yes, we have the full coverage in conformance with the Maine Tort Claims Act.
Want to protect the town.
I appreciate that, Counselor.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Item number 85, approval of the 7 a.m. as the poll opening time for the presidential preference primary to be held on March 7th, 2000.
I move that we recommend the 7 a.m. opening.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we approve the 7 a.m. opening time for the presidential primary to be held on March 7th. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. That ends our regular discussion for items on the agenda. Are there any citizens' discussions of items not on the agenda?
Just wanted to say something briefly. If any citizen would like to get a copy of the agenda, we are from now on preparing a distribution list of council agendas. So anyone that wants to be permanently added until they tell us that they don't want it, to be sent an email for every agenda, if they just simply send an email to cetm@maine.rr.com or just write us a note or send an email to cetown@maine.rr.com, we will add you to the distribution list so that you'll get the agendas automatically, and you'll also, and for those that don't want to do that, it's also usually available, not always, but almost always available on the webpage as well. But we will be happy to email the agenda on a regular basis to anyone who desires so.
Thank you. There is an item number 86, action upon request to enter into executive session to give instructions to the town manager relating to collective bargaining negotiations and to complete the annual evaluation of the town manager. There was no action anticipated to be taken at the executive session. I would like for the public to know that these negotiation items concern police department negotiations, and I have checked with the town attorney. I will not be participating in that discussion as there is a clear conflict since my son is a policeman in Cape Elizabeth. However, there does not seem to be any problem with my running the meeting, according to the town attorney, unless the council disagrees. There is, as I say, no action anticipated at this meeting. Thank you very much and good evening.
Do we need to move?
We need to move.
Move that we adjourn?
I see. Move that we go into executive.
Executive session, sorry.
We don't adjourn yet.
No.
In the agenda item will indicate the reasons you're going into executive session.
Right.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
All those in favor? Yes, discussion.
I didn't hear you. I'm sorry. Was it a motion to adjourn?
No.
Motion to go into executive session.
Executive session.
All motion to motion.
For that, I shall vote.
All right.
Not returning to public.
We are, however, not returning to public session.
Except for you.